Hello everyone, welcome back to the course of software engineering. This video is brought to you by Newton's Group of Institutions, Macherla. This is Arvind Egireddy from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, CEO Redefined Solutions. In this video, we will discuss about requirements modeling, its scenarios, information and analysis classes, and requirements analysis. Now coming to requirements modeling, scenarios, information and analysis classes, we need to first understand requirements. What is it? Before we begin any technical work, it is a good idea to apply a set of requirements engineering tasks. These tasks lead to an understanding of what the business impact of the software will be, what the customers want, and how end users will interact with the software. Who does it? Software engineers, sometimes referred to as system engineers or analysts in the IT world, and other project stakeholders like managers, customers, and end users all participate in the requirements engineering. And why it is important? Designing and building an elegant computer program that solves the wrong problem serves no one's needs. That's why it is important to understand what the customer wants before we begin to design and build a computer-based system. Now, what are the steps? Requirements engineering begins with inspection. That is a task that defines the scope and nature of the problem to be solved. It moves onwards to elicitation, a task that helps the stakeholders to define what is required, and then elaboration, where the basic requirements are refined and modified. As the stakeholders define the problem, negotiations occur. What are the priorities? What is essential? What is required? And finally, the problem is specified in some manner and then reviewed or validated to ensure that we understand the problem and the stakeholders understand the problems. They both coincide. Now, what is a work product? The intent of requirement engineering is to prove all the parties with the written understanding of the problem. This can be achieved through number of work products, usage scenarios, functions and features, list, requirement models or a specification. Now, how do I ensure that I have done it right? So here, the requirements engineering work products are reviewed with the stakeholders to ensure that what we have learned is what they really meant. Now, coming to the requirement analysis, requirement analysis results in the specification of the software operational characteristics, which indicates the software interface with other system elements and established constraints that software must meet. So here, requirement analysis allows us to elaborate on the basic requirements established during the inception, elicitation, and negotiation tasks, which are the part of the requirement engineering. So here, the requirements gathered in the software engineering is a process of identifying the requirements and real-world use cases of the software system to be built. So this modeling process consists of various types of modeling techniques, such as scenario-based, class-based, behavior-oriented, flow-oriented, and data-oriented modeling. Now, let us see the first model, that is scenario-based modeling. So this is typically the first stage of requirement modeling, where the top-level requirements are collected. Although there is no hard and fast rule to initiate the modeling with this phase, that is the phase where the top-level use cases are identified and described. The use case diagrams give the overview of interactions of the various actors within the system. So this is the preliminary user interactions with the system, which shows how the users are going to use the system, which sort out any high level ambiguities. Although the success of the computer based systems or product is measured in many ways, user satisfaction resides at the top of its list. If we can understand how the end users and other actors want to interact with a system, our software team will be better able to properly characterize the requirements and build a meaningful analysis and design models. Hence, requirements modeling with UML begins with the creation of the scenarios in the form of use cases, activity diagrams, and swim lane diagrams. So from the requirements engineering standpoint, this phase of modeling provides two ways of document requirements. One is inception and elicitation. So in some cases, use case diagrams become the primary candidate for the requirements. Now coming to the second model, that is class-based modeling. So here, class-based modeling enables to identify the system entities and operations in the form of classes, objects, and relationships, more like object-oriented technology. So here, class-based modeling represents the objects that the system will manipulate, the operations that will be applied to the objects to affect the manipulation, relationship between the objects, and the collaboration that occurs between the classes that are defined. The elements of a class-based model includes classes, objects, attributes, operations, classes, responsibility, collaborator models, collaboration diagrams, and packages. So the class identification process starts with identifying the classes from description of the project. Certain grammar entities helps for categorizing the classes. And the very first thing to look for the description is to people or devices that would potentially create the data in the system, such as customers, store managers, cashiers, delivery persons, so on. Then coming to the third model, that is behavioral pattern based modeling. So here the behavioral based requirement modeling relies on the system behavior, and the analysis can be viewed as a whole system objects interacting or collaborating with each other. So all those use case models collectively represent the behavior model. Behavior modeling helps us defining the software applications as a whole system and paints the blueprint of the system, showing various objects interacting with each other within the system or in its subsystem. So here the behavior modeling enables the initial view of the system's use case, which makes it easier to identify and flush in overall requirements. The creation of the behavior model is incremental or iterative process, which may lead to the changes to the other models as the system evolves. So these changes are typically due to any deficiency or change in the overall flow, and which can impact the class-based model and scenario-based models, because we might need to change the classes as a new behavior identified, or might have to change the entire scenario. So here the behavior models typically consists of various types of UML diagrams, such as sequence diagrams and interaction diagrams, and each of them entails the detailed flow of use cases. Here the sequence diagram in behavioral model represents the sequence of events or operations that happen in response to an action of an actor within the system. So communication diagrams can also play an important role in defining the system behavior, as it shows messages passing within the and across the system and group of objects interacting with each other within the system. Now coming to the flow-oriented modeling. So here the flow-oriented modeling basically focuses on the workflow of the overall system, and it acts like a supplement to the use case models. Here the activity diagrams and swim lane diagrams help in most situations in the phase of modeling. Activity diagram for the system gives nice visual for interactions of the system. Each action or operation is represented in the form of activity, and the actors, either internal or external to the system, perform these activities to show the control flow of the system. So here the activity diagram also shows parallelism within the system, and which can be used to optimize the pipeline of activities to perform the optimally. For example, mostly the activities of the system are synchronous one activities, which lead to another one only if it is completed. But sometimes it can be paralyzed to scale the system, and some activities can be converted to behave asynchronously in order to make the system efficient and scalable. Now, data-oriented modeling. Here, data-oriented modeling deals with the data aspects of the system and visualizes the system as a data operated and processed within the system. So, in software requirements, which include the need to create, extend, or interface with a database, or if complex data structures must be constructed and manipulated, the software team may choose to create the data models as part of the overall requirements modeling. A software engineer or an analyst defines all the data objects that are processed within the system. The relationship between the data objects and other information that is pertain to the relationship. So here the entity relationship diagram, ERD, which addresses these issues and represent all the data objects that are entered, stored, transformed, and produced within an application. So this kind of modeling represents every object in the form of data, which is composed of various properties. So here, each data item that represents the different objects of the system with various characteristics and states of each object. So these objects can be anything which belongs to a system and it holds the data only, and there is not any reference to its operations, etc. So these models provide a software designer with information that can be translated architecturally, and information and component level diagrams. And finally, the requirement model provides the developers and the customers with the means to access the quality once the software is being built. So here, the overall objective and philosophy. So throughout the requirements modeling, primary focus is on what and not on how. So what user interactions occur in a particular circumstances? What objects does the system manipulate? What functions must the system perform? What is the behavior, and what behavior does the system exhibit? And what interfaces are defined, at what conventions are applied? So here, in this model, we can clearly see that throughout the requirements modeling, the primary focus is on what, not on how. So this figure, the requirement model as a bridge between the system description and the design model. So here the requirement model must achieve three primary objectives. One is to describe what the customer requires. Then to establish a basis from the creation of the software design, and to identify a set of requirements that can be validated once the software is being built. So here the analysis model bridges the gap between the system level description that describes the overall system or a business functionality as it is achieved by applying software, hardware, data, humans, and other system elements, and the software design that describes the software application architecture, user interface, and component level structures. Now, the second is analysis rules of thumb. So here Arlo and Neustadt, they suggested a number of worthwhile rules of thumb that should be followed when creating an analysis model. So here Arlo and Neustadt. So here the first rule is the model should focus on the requirements that are visible within the problem or business domain. The level of abstraction should be relatively high. And the second rule is each element of the requirement model should be added to an overall understanding of the software requirement and provide insight into the information domain, functions and behavior of the system. And the third rule is we need to delay considerations of infrastructure and other non-functional models until design. That is, a database may be required, but the classes necessary to implement it, the functions required to access it, and the behavior that will be exhibiting or exhibited as it is used should be considered only after the problem domain analysis has been completed. And the fourth rule is minimize coupling throughout the system. So it is important to represent the relationship between the classes and functions. However, if the levels of the interconnections is extremely high, an effort should be made to reduce it. And the fifth rule is be certain that the requirement model provides values to all stakeholders. So here, each constituency has its own use for the model. And the sixth rule is keep the model as simple as it can be. So we need not create additional diagrams when they add no new information. And we should not use complex notational forms when a simple list will can do it. So these rules are being designed by Arlo and Neustadt. Now coming to the third one, that is domain analysis. So here domain analysis does not look at the specific application, but rather at the domain in which the application resides. Here the specific application domain can range from an avionics to banking, from multiple video games to software embedded within the medical devices. So here the goal of domain analysis is very, very straightforward. That is to identify common problem solving elements that are applicable to all applications within the domain and to find or create those analysis classes and our analysis patterns that are broadly applicable so that they can or they may be reduced. Here, the analysis patterns often reoccur across many applications within a specific business domain. If these patterns are defined and categorized in a manner that allows us to recognize and apply them to solve the common problems. So here, to improve time to market and reduce the development costs. Here, we have the input as a technical literature, existing application, customer surveys, expert advice, current or future requirements. So these inputs are being taken by the domain analysis. So here, domain analysis does not look at the specific application, but rather at the domain in which the application resides. So here the intent is to identify the common problem solving elements that are applicable to all applications within the domain. Domain analysis may be used or can be viewed as an umbrella activity for the software process. Now, this figure which illustrates the key inputs and outputs for the domain analysis process. Here, source of domain knowledge are surveyed in an attempt to identify the objects that can be reused across the domain, and these are the inputs that are being given to the domain analysis. Now, this domain analysis, they output class taxonomies, reuse standards, functional models and domain languages and make a domain analysis model. Now coming to the fourth one, that is the requirement modeling approaches. One view of requirement modeling called structured analysis consider data and the process that transfers the data as a separate entities. Here the data objects are modeled in a way that defines their attributes and relationships. The second approach to analysis modeling is called as an object-oriented analysis, which basically focus on the definition of classes and the manner in which they collaborate with one another to affect the customer requirements. So UML and the unified process are predominantly object-oriented. So here each element of the requirement model is presented in the following figure. They present the problems from different point of view. So here the scenario based element, they depict how the user interacts with the system and the specific sequence of activities that occur as the software is being used. Then the second objective is class based element model. So here the class based element model, the objects that the system will manipulate, the operations that will be applied to the objects to affect the manipulation and the relationship between the objects and the collaborations that occur between the classes that are defined. And coming to behavioral elements, here the behavioral elements, they depict how the external events change the state of the system or the classes that reside within its family. Now coming to the fourth, that is flow oriented elements, they represent the system as an information transforms, depicting how the data objects are transformed as they flow through various system functions. So thanks for listening to my video till the end with patience. Thank you one and all. If you like this video, please subscribe to my channel and press the bell icon for latest notifications. Thank you one and all.